seem to be touching on what's always been a discussion issue, which is acceptable risk. Mm-hmm. So for an organization, I'll start probably with Bobby, with an organization that does one-of-a-kind missions, that is supposed to push the envelope, but also wants to have success, how do we define acceptable risk, and how do we approach the whole issue of what's acceptable when we're dealing with risk?
Well, I think the agency needs to think about this really hard. And the way I view acceptable risk is kind of in a tiered sense. Obviously, for a human spaceflight system where astronauts are on board, where lives are at risk, and safety is, you know, paramount, we're going to, you know, be very careful, and we're not going to take a lot of risk. We're going to try to drive all the risk out of the system as best we can. But that failure is not an option mentality. While it might be acceptable in some cases for human spaceflight, we certainly don't want to take that approach across the board. And so as you go from human spaceflight to, let's say, large flagship missions in our science mission directorate, where we're, by the way, risking a great deal of money, a great deal of people's time, I think we can take more risk with those systems. Still, we need to be careful because of the investments being made. And as you move from our large flagship missions down to smaller competed missions, and certainly down to technology development, the area that I'm focused in the new office of the chief technologist, I think there we have to take risk, right? Technology development without risk, frankly, I don't know how to do that. Mm-hmm. The only time in my career that I ever felt like I was being innovative, and I'm not actually sure that I was, but I at least felt that way. The only time I ever felt like I was being innovative is when I was taking risk, and I was making decisions in an informed risk-taking manner, where I was balancing risk versus performance versus cost. And if in our technology programs, if we're going to be going after grand challenges, if we're going to be, as you say, pushing the envelope, doing cutting-edge things, we absolutely have to be able to do that. So I like to think about acceptable risk in a tiered manner, as I've been describing. And unfortunately, in the agency, I would say that from time to time, it's been more of a pendulum approach, where we take a lot of risk for a while, and then we get snake bit. And so we become very risk averse. And I think that for an agency like NASA, there has to be a balance. And there has to be a balance across time and across these different types of missions in the way we deal with risk.
I would say, though, Bobby, that if you look at, this is where we get into a little debate, right? Okay. So I generally agree with your perspective about balance, right? That makes a lot of sense. But if you look at, for example, we're talking about return to flight, how the shuttle team itself and how the space station team themselves have matured to the point where we deal with risk every single day, mm-hmm. and we manage the risk. And it's, I agree again with the tiers, but there's two things. There's our understanding of the risk, which is limited, and then the actual risk that you're dealing with, right? And so as there's a gap between our understanding and the real risk, we've got to go learn how to deal with that and how to run human spaceflight programs, at least in my case, exist in human spaceflight programs that allow you to deal with that risk and fly time after time after time. Otherwise, you'd want to stay on the ground. And so we've learned to fly missions and fly crews on space station without systems being pristine, right? By understanding the risks associated with next level failures, by having the kind of functional redundancy we have on space station. And then look on shuttle. You can't run flight after flight after flight since return to flight with such a success record without mm-hmm. understanding and appreciating the risks that go in each time. For example, when we went back to return to flight, we absolutely had a very low risk tolerance. The pendulum did swing. But the team has significantly matured over time to where we've gotten into situations where we don't fully understand the risk. We know there's some residual risk, as Brian O'Connor likes to say. Yet we talk about it. We talk about the uncertainties associated with the risk on a particular problem. And then we decide whether or not, among all the other constraints that weigh into flying programs, whether that risk is in balance with the rest of the risks we have. One example would be, you know, look at shuttle and station and how integrated they are. when you keep the shuttle on the ground, that puts station and the station crew at risk to some degree. Sure. And so you have to make those technical risk decisions in context of coupled programs and whether or not we have the right risk balance. And I think the agency, in particular in SOMD, has done a really great job lately of trying to find and navigate way through these tough technical issues and still continue to fly.
Yeah, I think that we're saying actually the same thing in different ways, maybe. I believe what you're saying, Steve, is that it's through understanding the system that we understand the risk and we can then make those trades. And so it's by empowering the engineers that are the ones that actually understand the system, right? Empowering them with that responsibility to make those decisions as opposed to trying to bubble that all up to the top every time, that we can make informed risk trades. And I think that's true whether you're talking about a human spaceflight system or whether we're talking about, you know, the next robotic mission to Mars. The one thing that I learned on Pathfinder, Mars Pathfinder, I learned every day is, you know, the people down in the trenches that are closest to the knowledge are actually best able to make these risk trades. And on Pathfinder, it was a beautiful environment because it allowed those people to actually make those decisions. That's the way the Mars Pathfinder team was run from day one. And it was a great, when I look back on it, it was a great developmental experience for me, colored my whole approach to my professional career. But I think it was also a great developmental experience for everyone else on that team as well.
Well, I think when you talk to any of the younger folks coming into the agency today, whether you're talking about cooperative education students or new hires, the number one thing that they ask for is accountability.
Yeah.
Let me be responsible for and accountable for some deliverable. Mm-hmm. And that's what engages and excites or motivates our workforce.